the morning star, drive on 17.8. You soaring up with sky, now's the time, don't delay. I'm sitting in my ride and it's time to fly. So let's realign, just listen and fill your mind.
I'm burning with desire and the passion. Nobody can stop me when I'm like this. I got my head in the zone, you know. I'm on the morning star, drive, you know.
Hey guys, how's it going? It's Tuesday, April 27th, and this is the Morning Star Drive on 117.8. We're on YouTube, so make sure to subscribe, follow us on SoundCloud, and make sure to support us on Patreon. So today we'll get some coronavirus updates, current news from around the world, the best class ever segment from Sean Juzang McMillan, and of course, once again, this week too, we'll be looking at the Book of Psalms. Alright guys, how are you doing today? Monday is out of the way, and I hope you guys are enjoying the beginning of this week. Thankful you guys are joining us here on the Morning Star Drive. Keep liking and commenting, and want to hear from you guys and see how you're doing. Yes, guys, tonight there's going to be a Lab 78 live show. It's going to be at 8 p.m., but at 4 p.m., just like, you know, a few hours before it, I'm going to be doing my interview with Malaysia Immigration, so it's going to be pretty tight, but pretty happy to see what's going to happen, so we'll see. We'll see what the interview turns into. I'm not sure exactly what's going to happen, but, you know, I'm praying just that the right thing happens, right? So, I will be talking live about how my interview went and the process of staying in Malaysia, if I get to stay or if I have to leave by the end of the week or whatever it is. So, who knows? By next week, I could be in another country. Last Sunday edition, we met Dabiel from Hawaii. Just a great interview, learning about her journey into this history. Super fun, insightful interview. She's been in Providence for over 25 years. I know a lot of you guys are enjoying it, so make sure to check out the Sunday edition this week. Last night, Monday Zoom Bible study. It will be posted on Patreon today, so I hope you guys will enjoy that too. So let's get this show started on the road on this tubular terrific Tuesday, guys. It's gonna be so cool. All right. So who's a featured artist of the day? Today's featured artist is from Japan. It is Kumachung with the song Open My Eyes. And then we'll get to PGY with the Paper Music Associates in Korea. And that is Dr. Rain is the title of that song. And last but not least is Renee Lai from Taiwan. And that song is a cover of a song from someone named Meng Run, and the song is called, the translation is Youth or Youngster. I'm not sure which one they're going to use, but that is a translation for it. All right, so let's enjoy this time with music from our amazing member artists from around the world.
Open the eyes, open the door, open my heart, mi kokoro sagaste. Open the eyes, open the door, open my heart, mirai te samare. You and I, they go, you and I, they go. Donna kana, hakurai ga kitemo, doji nai, tsuyo, shinko, motte, tachi, mukao, wo. Family, they go, family, they go. Subete no hito wo ukeirerareru, kazoku no yona, atatakasa wo motte, yuko. Shu no mikokoro, fasto de yuko. Itsumo shu no shinjou to, tomoni shu no kotoba wo, tai yusen ni shite, ugoki dasu. に発展に積極的に貢献しよう近づいてこう近づいてこう全ての世代と距離を近く親しく接した縄は僕を襲う縛られてる心を捨ててこう新しい取り組みをしよう主の言葉で心を燃やして動き出そうどんどんチャレンジしよう
CGM オープンの先駆者たち
して強みを生かし大胆になろう伝えたい I'm happy, I'm happy 新しく You're shining, 伝えたい I'm happy, I'm happy 新しく You're shining, you're shining 主の御言葉に出会い全て与えられた何もない私だったけど育ててくれたその愛をいつまでも忘れずにいよう もらったもの全て捧げ御心なさい 御言葉を実践し挑戦して
记得你是你呀、啊。 的每道光，让世界因为你的存在变得闪亮。其实你我他并没有什么不同，只要你愿为希望画出一道想象。成长的路上必然经历很多风雨，相信自己终有属于你的胜局。别因为磨难停住你的脚步，坚持住就会拥有属于你的蓝图。
And there you have it. That is Renee Lai from Taiwan with Youngster or Youth from the singer Meng Ren. All right. Before that was PGY from the Paper Music Associates in Korea with Dr. Rain. And of course, the feature artist of the day is Kuma Chang from Japan with the song Open My Eyes. All right, guys. So let's get into some current news from around the world, see what's going on. I'll start off with some coronavirus updates. 147.6 million cases in the world with 3 million deaths. But great news because mortality rate has gone down once again to 2.11%. Top six countries going by daily infection rates. We have the US with 32.7 million cases, 585,000 deaths at 1.79%. India, 17.2 million cases, 194,000 deaths at 1.13%. Brazil, 14.3 million cases, 389,000 cases with 2.72%. And they are not going up mortality rate, which is good news for one day. France, 5.4 million cases, 102,000 deaths at 1.87%. Turkey, 4.6 million cases, 38,000 deaths at 0.83%. And then Germany, 3.2 million cases, 82,000 deaths at a 2.5% mortality rate. Sweden, only country not to go into lockdown, remains at 1.48%. And Belgium drops to 2.47%. All right, so here it is. Daily infection rates. Now, daily infection rates are important, but they're not as important as the mortality rates. But, you know, they keep changing the goalposts. But we're going to just stay here and take a look at how many cases there are in a day. India just constantly setting new records. 349,000 cases in a single day. And then you have Brazil with 70. The U.S. 53, and Turkey with 40,000 cases in a single day, and then France with 32, and then Germany with 24,000. Interesting, Germany's back in the mix, 24,000 cases in a day. Here in Southeast Asia, we have the Philippines with 9,600 cases, and then Indonesia with 4,500, and Malaysia with 2,700 cases in a single day, which is not too bad. All right, so let's take a look at the top three news. So we did hear a couple days ago, there is an Indonesian Navy submarine that went missing. Okay, they finally found it. They found it split into three on the seabed. I forget how deep it was, but no, it was like 800 meters. So that's really, really deep, right? Indonesian Navy submarine sank off the coast of Bali on Wednesday and has been found split into three pieces on the seabed. Officials say all the vessel's 53 crew have been confirmed dead, and the Navy officials said they have received signals from the sub's location more than 2,600 feet or 800 meters deep early on Sunday. Now, an underwater rescue vehicle loaned by Singapore was sent down to get visual confirmation on the wreckage, and the KRI Nanggala, which is the name of the sub, disappeared after requesting permission to dive during a torpedo drill. The reason for its sinking is not clear yet, but Sunday's statement came a day after the Indonesian military confirmed that debris from the sub, including prayer mats, had been found in the area where it went missing. So the Navy Chief of Staff said more items from the submarine had been recovered, including an anchor and crew safety suits. So the KRI Nanggala is divided into three parts. The hull of the ship, the stern, and the main parts are all separated, with the main part found cracked. He told reporters on Sunday, the head of Indonesia's military confirmed that there was no chance of finding any of the crew alive. So obviously with deep sadness, they said all 53 personnel have died from the wreckage. And experts had said earlier that the depth at which the submarine was found was well beyond its survivable limit, and it was only carrying enough oxygen for 3 days. So the president of Indonesia described the crew as Indonesia's best patriots, adding all Indonesians convey their deep sadness over this incident, especially to the families of the sub crew. Right, so this is a German-built vessel, which was more than 40 years old, but underwent a refit in 2012. On second news, Australia provoking China. Right, provokes China anger over scrap deals. So Australia has scrapped agreements tied to China's Belt and Road Initiative, prompting anger from Beijing and adding further strain to tense relations between the two countries. The federal government used new powers to rip up two deals made between the state of Victoria and China. Canberra said it was backing away from the agreements to protect Australia's national interest, and the Chinese embassy in Australia's branded Australia branded the move as provocative, and it said the action by Canberra was bound to bring further damage to bilateral relations and will only end up hurting itself. And it further shows that the Australian government has no sincerity in improving China-Australian relations. Right, so it's the first time Canberra has used the powers to veto deals made by states, local governments, or public university with foreign countries, and the laws allow the government to cancel agreements deemed to threaten Australia's national interests. Now, in addition to the China deals, the foreign minister also scrapped agreements with Iran and Syria, and they were a memorandum of understanding sealed between Victoria's Education Department and Iran, signed in 2004, and a 1999 scientific cooperation agreement signed with Syria. So these four agreements were basically the senators were saying it was inconsistent with Australia's foreign policy, right? And speaking to the Australian Broadcast Corporation, the senators defended the government's decision and said they did not expect China to retaliate, right? So basically the government is acting, as they say, in the national interest, and they're very careful and considerate in this approach. And this was said on radio programs. Yes, there is escalating tensions, though. The Victoria state's decision to sign up to China's Belt and Road Initiative with two agreements in 2018 and 2019 drew criticism from the federal government, as well as then U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and the sweeping infrastructure project, which aims to expand global trade links, has funded trains, roads, and ports in many countries, but has left some saddled with debt. Now, seen as a bold bid by President Xi Jinping for geopolitical influence, the U.S. has been particularly critical of China's so-called debt diplomacy. So the move to cut ties with the initiative comes against backdrop of deteriorating tensions between Canberra and Beijing. And China is Australia's largest trading partner, and before the pandemic, its biggest source of overseas university students. Now, relations have worsened in recent years, leading to diplomatic and trade, ructions. So trade ties have been particularly strained since Australia first called for a rigorous investigation into the origins of the coronavirus pandemic in April. And Canberra has taken other steps to curtail Chinese influence in the country, including putting a ban on telecom giant Huawei from building Australia's 5G network and tightening foreign investment laws. Right, so that's quite interesting there. Last but not least, ASEAN. Right, demands immediate cessation of violence to Myanmar. So ASEAN is the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, issues a 5-point statement calling for a constructive dialogue to resolve the Myanmar coup crisis. So the Association of ASEAN has released a 5-point statement on the crisis in Myanmar, demanding the immediate cessation of violence and calling on all parties in the country to exercise utmost restraint. So Myanmar is part of the 10-nation ASEAN and has been in turmoil since the military overthrew the government on February 1st, triggering a mass uprising from all corners of society demanding a return to democracy. And the ASEAN document issued on Saturday following an ASEAN emergency summit in Jakarta also called for constructive dialogue to resolve the crisis. So all parties concerned shall commence to seek a peaceful solution in the interests of the people. And this is what ASEAN said. And it added that a special envoy of the ASEAN chair shall facilitate mediation of the dialogue process with the assistance of the Secretary General of ASEAN. So ASEAN also said it would provide humanitarian assistance and said that the special envoy and delegation would visit Myanmar to meet with all parties concerned. Earlier on Saturday, Indonesian President Joko Widodo said after crisis talks with military and coup leader of Myanmar, the Southeast Asian leaders together with him and Myanmar's military must restore democracy and stop committing violence against citizens. So the meeting marked the senior Myanmar general's first foreign trip since security forces staged a coup in early February, right? So already this crackdown has seen more than 700 die. And all ASEAN leaders are asking for the violence to absolutely stop and democracy to come out from this. And they want to restore the peace. And they also call for the release of political prisoners and for a special envoy to be allowed into the country to push for dialogue. So it is something that I think not only the ASEAN countries, but I think the entire world are looking for peace to be restored over there in Myanmar and to get, you know, to restore everything back to where it was, especially with that... With the elections that went on, and there was an overwhelmingly 80% victory for the pro-democracy side. So, you know, at the moment, there's still a lot of ongoing protests going on in Myanmar. And, of course, a lot of people beating pots and pans and holding signs saying democracy for Myanmar and people standing against the military coup. So there are still protests going on massively right now. So the general's involvement in the Jakarta talks is good news, though. It is good news. Right. And it good news, meaning that at least the other leaders can pressure the leader to start making things better, even though everyone else is saying that, oh, activists are angered, right, that you have this general who's involved with these talks. But I think it's actually a good thing that he can get pressure from other leaders and that he sees and they all see that they're all saying and the general sees that he's wrong at this point. So, you know, usually ASEAN generally takes a hands-off approach to members' internal affairs, but this is something that's really, really big, a very humanitarian move more than anything else. So that is what's going on around the world. Those are the top three news items. Hope you guys really got some more information on what is going on around the world, which means that now that the worldly news is done, we're going to get into some praise and worship for today. What's going on, guys? It is a time for praise and worship, so I hope that all of us can... spend this time giving glory to the Holy Trinity. We're going to start off with something we've always wanted, and it's being made right now, which is the ideal world. We'll go to version 2, and then the gates of the wedding banquet have opened. And last but not least, especially for this week's message, we're going to sing the song according to the Lord's will. So as one body of the Morningstar Drive, let's make sure to give glory, praise, and honor to the Holy Trinity.
丢我。
There you go. That was According to the Lord's Will, and I hope it reminds you of this week's message. Before that, Gates of the Wedding Banquet have begun. Sorry, they have opened. And then last is Ideal World 2. All right, guys, so let's get into the word study for today. And it is Tuesday. So every Tuesday, we're going to go over the book. The scriptures where the book where the scriptures come from this week. And once again, it comes from Psalms. We did the same as last week. So I'm going to go over some other stuff about the book of Psalms that all of us can kind of get ourselves into. So kind of some interesting facts, right? Some interesting facts is like, you know, in the Bible, Psalms is actually the third longest book in the Bible, right? So Jeremiah is number one, Genesis is number two, and then Psalms is number three. And one thing's kind of cool about the book of Psalms is the book of Psalms is one of the books where, you know, you take worship songs from the book of Psalms, and it is used both in Judaism and Christianity. So I remember some of the songs from the book, songs from the book of Psalms, right? And one of them was called Create in Me a Clean Heart. And that was a really famous one back in my days in the former faith. And that was a song that we sang a lot. Very, very deep song. It's right after he committed adultery with Bathsheba, and he's asking God to clean his heart, and he's just asking for repentance. So that's, I know it's a song from the Psalms that we use. And I know that Judaism also uses many of the songs from the book of Psalms also. Another interesting thing is, the book of Psalms is the most quoted, like word for word, most quoted from Jesus. Jesus quoted the book of Psalms more than any other book in the Old Testament. At the moment, we know that there's 150 books in the Old Testament, And if you go to the Jewish Book of Psalms, there's actually an extra book in there, the 151. And that one is supposedly written by King David, and that's after he slayed Goliath, which is quite interesting, right? The authors, like if we want to know how many authors there actually are, there's 102 that are known and 48 that are still unknown. So of the 102, David wrote 75 of them, okay? And then there's also six other authors. Of course, we know Solomon was one of them, but Solomon only wrote two of the other Psalms. Moses actually wrote one of them also. And then there's four other authors that you'll hear about. Like, well, some of them aren't as famous as like Moses, Solomon, and David. But David wrote 75 of the 150. In the Jewish Bible, you know, whenever you read the book of Psalms, they always say Selah, right? S-E-L-A-H. And you're like, well, what does that mean? Well, the actual meaning of the word Selah means forever. And it has like, it's an instruction to break during singing. Or if you're reading the Bible, it is a call to break, right? To think about what you just read, which is quite interesting, right? So Selah, right? So in song, it means to break in the singing. And when you're reading the Bible, it means to take a break and think of what you just read right now. So whenever you see the word Selah, you should kind of slow down and think about, what did I just read? There are six or seven, is it seven? There's like these penitential psalms, and one of them I told you about was when David repented for committing adultery. And basically these seven penitential psalms are used for confession of sins, right? So I think it's like Psalms 6, 32, 38, 51, a couple of them in the hundreds too, that you can see that they are very penitential, and a lot of people in Christianity and both Judaism use them as penitential or for asking for forgiveness. So also there's the last thing I'm going to end up with here is there are five words. There's five key words to summarize the book of Psalms. Okay. So the first one is praise, right? So the psalmist worships, extols, and with like that heartfelt gratitude, thanks the sovereign God of Israel for being alive, for the words of God, his mighty works, in regards both to just like general creation and also redemption. So the first one is praise. Second one is prophecy. So the psalmist often writes of the coming of the Messiah, foretelling like the Messiah will come with zeal, suffering, death, resurrection, ascension, the high priestly work, and the coming millennial reign, right? The third word you can use to summarize Psalms is pain. So the psalmist describes in graphic fashion his personal doubts, fears, pain, and problems. Petition. Right, the psalmist offers up many requests, crying out for relief, forgiveness, reassurance, direction, protection, strength. And last but not least, there's poetry. Right, the psalmist pens his words in poetic fashion, meant to be sung more than anything else. So that is kind of just a quick word study we're going to have on the book of Psalms. We did it last week too, so go ahead and take a look at last week's Tuesday if you want to get refreshed on the book of Psalms too. All right, guys, so that is today's word study. Hope you guys enjoyed that right there too, which means we're going to go into The song of choice for today. Song of choice comes from old school dude from the 2000s, I believe, 90s and 2000s. His name is Babyface, right? Kenneth Edmonds. And this guy is someone who's known as a singer and songwriter. He's known as songwriting first, and then he became a singer too. But he's a great singer. He's got that really, that classy, it's like a very soft and calm tone, kind of a Smokey Robinson style, but very, very soothing voice. His name is Babyface, and this is one of his favorites, one of his first famous songs. It's called Never Keeping Secrets, right? So I hope this is a song that you can listen to and think about never keeping secrets from God. Well, you know, you can't really keep secrets from God. It's just God knows everything, but you got to confess it, right? So this song is called Never Keeping Secrets, and this is from Babyface.
The truth.
That was Babyface with Never Keeping Secrets. Man, that's an old school song. So many of these songs from the 90s and 2000s, I really miss. I really had, just remember those days in high school in the beginning of university. I know, guys, for you guys, that's like not the 90s. For 90s for me was, high school. That was high school for me for Babyface, those Babyface days. Yeah, when I had a Babyface, not anymore though. Either way, so what does that mean? It means that it's time for today's awesome new segment. Well, we always have a segment on Tuesday. It's going to be another new segment from Sean Jusek McMillan over there in Texas. And this is the best class ever.
Recently, we spoke about the big five personality traits. But which of these traits do you think great leaders typically have? Do you think a great leader would typically be higher or lower in openness? Conscientiousness. I'll bet a lot of us would typically expect extroverts to be great leaders, but why wouldn't introverts be good at leading? Extroverts might be more willing to try and win elections, but that doesn't necessarily make them better leaders, does it? My name is Sean Jung-Joo-Song McMillan, and this is the best class ever. In fact, a study that compared hiring practices, performance results, and even successful CEOs revealed that there is no ideal personality temperament for great leaders. Some great leaders were high in extroversion, but just as many were not. Of course, they need to be intelligent enough to deal with the problems, but not all CEOs are particularly creative, assertive, enthusiastic, or agreeable. just as many are introverted, conscientious, unassuming, reserved, or disagreeable. We even find that, allowed to guess intuitively, people really cannot predict who will make good leaders or not. Some research has found that choosing people to be the leader at random, as opposed to holding elections, produced leaders who were just as good. In fact, it allowed for people who might otherwise not volunteer to be leaders to really show their potential. Elections are essentially popularity contests, but voters and HR departments don't seem to have any discernment about leadership potential when you look at the data. Who is to say that those who want to be leader should be leader? Maybe the ones who does not want to be leader will be less tempted by the trappings of leadership. I heard a great line the other day from a TV show that came out 6 years ago, before the two most recent presidential elections. In the show, two psychologists were talking about President Nixon's irrational paranoia. One asked, "How could someone who is sociopathic become president?" And the other responded, "How could you not be sociopathic to want to become president?" Everyone seemed to notice that Steve Jobs could be a real asshole. But he is also known as a visionary and is one of the most famous CEOs of all time. He definitely ranked very low in agreeableness. So people often ask, was being a jerk part of what made him so great? Perhaps it was his sheer force of will, his tactical use of humiliation, and complete disregard for people's feelings that allowed him to be so demanding and made those who could not receive it desire to receive his approval. Steve Jobs personally chose Walter Isaacson to be his biographer. Isaacson had already written popular biographies on other famous innovators like Benjamin Franklin and Leonardo da Vinci. Isaacson agreed to write the biography with one condition. He reserved the right to express his own opinion without Steve being able to edit it. Steve agreed. Isaacson wrote in great detail about how humiliating it could be to work for Steve, and how Steve refused to acknowledge Lisa as his own daughter even after giving the new Macintosh computer her same name. Perhaps it was this unrelenting willingness to make demands of people and the withholding of acknowledgement that drove his employees to bring his vision into reality. At the end of the book, Isaacson had only one opinion he wanted to express about Steve Jobs. He concluded that what made Steve an unusual success had nothing to do with the way he treated people. The simple fact was, Steve did not need to be such an asshole, and the suffering it caused those close to him was totally unnecessary. Do great leaders need to work tirelessly long, endless hours? Perhaps it is better to be conscientious, meaning both orderly and industrious. Bill Gates certainly fit this profile when he was CEO of Microsoft. He said that he knew who worked late and who didn't because he was often the last one to leave. Now looking back, Bill says he sees the world entirely differently and takes far more vacations, even though now he oversees one of the largest philanthropy organizations in the world, taking on some of the world's most intractable problems. Amazon.com's founder and CEO, Jeff Bezos, does not work long hours. He is in fact famous for getting 8 hours of sleep every night and working only a few hours each day. He says that his job is to come in, make some of the most difficult decisions well, and leave the rest to his more than capable staff. Do elections produce good leaders? The research data tells us that picking leaders at random might work just as well as holding elections. As we discussed before, Socrates had some deep suspicions that, left to the wisdom of the mob, democracy does not always promote the best rulers. I mean, really, what does winning a popularity contest have to do with the merits required to make difficult decisions on behalf of large groups of people? Shakespeare, too, also explored this theme in many of his plays. What makes a wise leader? We may think we have a good intuition about who would make a great leader and who would not, but this does not turn out to be the case when we measure the results. We are finding that the way our human resource departments conduct interviews and use resumes are so riddled with bias that our confidence in a person's potential to join or lead a team has almost no correlation with their actual ability to perform the role when we compare the results later on. Recruiters tend to choose recruits who look and sound like themselves, leading to a lack of diversity. People who are good at interviewing aren't always good at doing the work. We tend to promote taller people, but what does height have to do with the ability to lead? Why would men make better leaders than women, or women any better than men? IQ and conscientiousness are the strongest indicators of success, but men and women score relatively the same on average on these two scales. Women do tend to score higher in agreeableness on average, which is a combination of politeness and compassion, but none of our research shows whether being high or low in these characteristics would make you a great leader. At a school in South America, they did an experiment where they allowed any student who wanted to be on the student leadership committee volunteer to be an elected leader. But they didn't hold any elections. They simply chose at random from all those who volunteered. Turns out, some introverts, who we all know typically would not try to win an election, turned out to be really great leaders. Sometimes students who no one would have guessed would make a good leader. Sometimes students who no one would have guessed would make a good leader really took the initiative, took responsibility for solving problems, and became really proactive. There were also cases where tall, handsome, charismatic leaders turned out to be totally irresponsible and unreliable. They might have fit the prototypical image of what we imagine a good leader to look like, but they just as often ended up neglecting their actual role and leaving their responsibilities to fall onto everyone else. Scholarship committees often have panels of professionals to judge the essays, college admissions applications, and/or grant proposals of the postgraduate students. There are often a few standout submissions, but how do you judge between the great majority of mediocre submissions? We could score them according to somewhat arbitrary metrics or judge them by granular metrics, but when the marginal differences between scores often skew so close to one another that you might as well choose at random. Well, why not just choose at random? At least choosing at random or by lottery is somewhat fair in terms of equal opportunity, and leaving it up to chance would at least remove some personal human bias. All of this is to say that anyone can make a great leader. Extroverts, introverts, those who are agreeable, those who are disagreeable. Men, women, from any background, from any country, whether high or low in neuroticism, or high or low in openness. If we really want great leaders, we should really watch out for our own personal biases towards the loud, outspoken, handsome, beautiful, and/or assertive tall people. You know, the ones we expect to win popularity contests. Let's give a chance to the quiet, unassuming, but thoughtful ones. Or even better, just pick at random from all those bold enough to volunteer. For more lessons or to follow up on some of the things we mentioned here, feel free to visit me at bestclassever.org.
And thank you so much, Sean Jusung McMillan, for another awesome episode of The Best Class Ever. Hope you guys got some good information about personality types of leaders. And it's something that we do need to think about, especially in this history as we're beginning it at the pioneering stage. It's only been 43 years, guys, which it may seem long to us because that's like our entire life. But if you think about it, it's not a very long time for a religion, right? So I hope that all of us here can really think about the different personality types and the different types of leaders that are out there that we can become great leaders. But I think when we look at all the things that are taught to us in this history, the greatest type of leader is the one that is absolutely connected to God first before anything else. And then after that comes the other things like personality and other different things like that too. But I really hope that we can produce some amazing leaders in this history that will not only just be leaders inside the churches, but leaders outside, like whether in businesses and jobs and stuff like this too. But super grateful and thankful for another episode by Jusung. Great job once again, and I hope you guys enjoyed that. And if you have any comments, go ahead and put that into the comment section. All right, guys, that means that is the end of today's podcast. This is a Tuesday podcast here. I hope you guys had a great time and a great morning or afternoon for some of you together here. And I hope we'll see each other once again. And we'll see you guys tomorrow on the Morningstar Drive on 117.8.
It's the Morning Star Drive 117.8. You soaring up with Sky, now's the time, don't delay. I'm sitting in my ride and it's time to fly. So let's realign, just listen and fill your mind.
I'm burning with desire and the passion. Nobody can stop me when I'm like this. I got my head in the zone, you know. I'm on the Morning Star Drive, you know. I'm burning with desire and the passion. Nobody can stop me when I'm like this. I got my head in the zone, you know. I'm on the Morning Star Drive.